illuminated from the scriptures I read. I've read this, I guess, hundreds of times. I don't know how many times I've read over this scripture. Almost every time I'll find something new, I'll look and something will pop out at me and I'll say, Lord, thank you for that. I've never even seen that before. But as we look at the Christmas story today, I want to bring a message to you this morning just simply entitled, Concerning This Child. And these words are from our scripture, and we'll bring that forth later on. But Luke chapter 2, we'll read this morning verses 1 through 20. It's 20 verses, it's rather long. It is the Christmas story. We're going to read over this. If you have your copy of God's Word, please turn there to Luke chapter 2, starting with verse 1. And here the Bible says, And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea under the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known unto us. And they came in haste, and found Mary and Joseph and the babe, lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much for once again allowing us to break open the bread of life, Lord, and to preach from your word. God, I pray that you illuminate this scripture this morning for every person in here. Lord, open our minds and hearts to receive this word. God, we thank you so much for the gift of your Son, Lord. We pray, Lord, that we are a shining example for him, Lord, and we lift up him and magnify him in all of our works and deeds. Lord, help us in this message. Preach it for us. Lord, you know I'm not worthy enough, but through you, Lord, all things are possible. God, we ask that you help us here this morning. These things I ask in the precious name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Very familiar passage of Scripture. We were talking just this week with folks about the old cartoon of the Charlie Brown where Linus gets up and he actually quotes the Scripture. He actually quotes it from the King James Bible, of all things. But we remember that. A lot of children, it's the first time they're exposed to the Christmas story. Many children today are not taken to church by their families. And things like that will have to suffice for them to hear the Christmas story, the real Christmas story. Sadly today, even we as Christians are a little confused on the true Christmas story. I want to kind of tell you this morning about how I feel that most people think on the Christmas story. And don't be offended this morning. I'm not making fun of anyone. We all have our thoughts and our ideas and what we've heard and learned as children. But this morning, what I feel like most people think of the Christmas story, we're going to leave out the retail stuff. We're not going to talk about that today. But we as Christians, as we think about the Christmas story, most people no doubt think about 2,000 years ago on December 25th, on a cold winter day, that Mary and Joseph came riding into Bethlehem to pay their income taxes. Mary was no doubt on a donkey riding down through there on her way. And they get to the inn, and they find the wicked evil innkeeper there at the door, refusing them a place to stay, even though Mary looks like she's about to have a child right now. She's about to just pop. And this evil innkeeper says, go away, there's no room for you. So they have to go out somewhere and look around until finally Joseph spots a barn or a cave, and they go in there, and Joseph delivers this baby, and it never cries, and angels are up above it, and they're singing Silent Night and all these things. And then three wise men or three kings all of a sudden suddenly appear and give them three gifts. And that's what most people think their thoughts of Christmas is. They take a little bit of this, a little bit of that, take it here and there. And no doubt that makes for real good television. That makes for real good movies. That makes for good Christmas cards and for little plays and pageants that we put on. It makes for some good things. I even heard of one church that put on a Christmas pageant about the evil, wicked innkeeper and how his son grew up to be Barabbas. And so many thoughts and things in people's heads and ideas that they get. But sadly, they didn't get these ideas from the Bible. You're not going to find most of those things that I mentioned this morning in your Bible. Most of those things are not in there. In fact, almost everything that I just mentioned is not in there. But sadly, many people think that is the Christmas story. But what I'd like for us to do today is look at this scripture we just read. And let's see what the Bible really says about Christmas. And before you get mad at me and tar and feather me and run me out of the church for being anti-Christmas, please just listen to what the Bible says this morning. Let's listen to the Bible. Verse 1 starts out and says, and it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria, and all went to be taxed, everyone, into his own city. Now this first verse says, in those days. What days is the Bible talking about? What days? Well, if you read the previous chapter, those days that John the Baptist came on the scene. Those days that Herod the king was reigning as king there in Israel and all over Judah and all around the regions there. In those same days that Joseph and Mary were told of this miraculous birth, of this Savior that Mary was going to have, this virgin birth. Those days is what the Bible is talking about. In those days that this following happened. It says that this taxing. What's this taxing? Well, a lot of people sadly confuse this with some income tax, like we pay on April 15th, that we have to go and make sure that everything's in. But this word taxing, this tax here that the Bible speaks of, in those days this word actually meant a count, a census, a assigning of your name to count everyone. It was a census. And so Mary and Joseph had to go to the place that they were from to sign up on this census. Now, granted, this census would lead to taxes. It would lead to everyone having to be taxed. The children of Israel didn't have to fight in the Roman army. The Roman army had their own soldiers, but the children of Israel still had to support the government through their taxes. Well, they wanted to make sure they got a count of everyone. And who asked for this counting? This man named Caesar Augustus. Now, who is this guy? Well, first of all, neither one of those is his real name. Caesar is not a name, it's a title. It's much like emperor or king or pharaoh. All those are titles to someone. He was the emperor of Rome. He was the Caesar. That was his title. Augustus was an adjective that described him, that was given to him by the Roman government, which actually was from the month of August, and it means someone that's great, someone that was honored, a majestic one. And so he went by this title. Caesar was his title, like president. Augustus, the revered one. Magnificent one, the great one. So he was the leader and the great leader, is what his name meant. His real name was Gaius Octavius. He was actually the great nephew of Julius Caesar. He was adopted by him, and Julius Caesar left all of his entire will to his great nephew that he adopted, Octavius. And so his real name was Octavius, but he went by this name. Now his word meant everything. He was the emperor of all of Rome. This covered all the regions in that area, Israel, Judah, Bethlehem. Herod, the king, was sitting upon the throne. He was just a puppet king that had to answer to everything to this Caesar. But although Herod did have power, he was allowed to have power amongst the children of Israel. And so Herod, as we know, was a very wicked king. We'll talk about him a little bit more later. But I just want you to get in mind who is doing the work here. And this Caesar that is mentioned, Caesar Augustus, he is not a saved man. He's not a Christian. He is not a Jew. In fact, he is nothing about God. They worshiped other gods. But God, through this Caesar, was able to do his work and got it all set up this way. Through this man, this taxing, this census, this counting, he's going to make sure that the person that he chose to deliver his son is going to be in the right place at the right time and just at the right second. If you remember in your scripture back in Micah, the prophet Micah said over in Micah 5:2, he says, "But thou, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though thou be little among thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting." So Micah predicted the birth of Jesus to come out of Bethlehem. So that is exactly where it had to take place. God worked through this Roman emperor, Caesar Augustus, to make sure that all this came about. Let's look at verse 4. "And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary as his spouse's wife, being great with child." Now, for Jesus to be who he said he is, for him to be the ruler of the world, for him to be the king of the Jews, king of Israel, king of the world, he had to comply with Scripture. Scripture said he had to be born in Bethlehem. He also had to come from the lineage of David. Joseph was not the blood father of Jesus, but did you understand that Jesus was adopted? Jesus was adopted. Joseph adopted Jesus. It was not his true blood son. But because of this adoption, because he's in the real family of Joseph from the lineage of David, the royal bloodline flows right through to him, making it all fall into place. I've heard it said that probably if kings had still been present in Israel, real kings, true kings of God, that Joseph would have rightfully been king of Israel. It went through his bloodline in that way. So Jesus can now claim to be from the royal bloodline all the way back to David. In fact, if you look over in Luke chapter 3, toward the end of the chapter, it gives the lineage of Jesus. And it goes all the way back to Adam and to God. So we can follow that bloodline. A lot of times we look at our Bibles and we read all these names. So-and-so begat him and begat this one and begat that. We say, "Lord, why in the world did you put all that in there?" I just go through there and glaze over. And why does it mean anything to me? Well, if you read that, you will see that it means everything. This lineage that traced all the way back to God, all through that bloodline, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and David, as it kept going on and on, and landed upon Joseph, which became the father of Jesus, giving him the right to the royal bloodline. It says his espoused wife. I had to explain this to some of our Sunday school kids not too long ago about how someone is a spouse. In our terms today, we're engaged to someone. They're your fiancé, I believe they say. That's who Mary was to Joseph, his fiancé. They were a spouse. Now, in that time period, this was lawfully done. They were a spouse to someone. It was you couldn't get out of that unless it was some kind of death or some kind of law they passed or a divorce decree. This was a binding thing to be a spouse to someone. Well, so, also, if you think about it, these two people, Mary and Joseph, they were approximately 13, 14, 15, very young, teenagers. And so the law has been laid upon these folks that the Lord is going to deliver the Savior through them. So Mary, just a young lady, 13 or 14 years old, we don't know exactly, the Bible doesn't say her age, but she is young. She's going to have this baby. Now you can imagine Joseph, as he finds out that his wife-to-be is going to have a baby. You can imagine the scorn and ridicule that he'd have to go through trying to explain this. "I never touched her." How he thought, as we saw in Matthew chapter 1, how he was thinking how he was going to privately put her away. He didn't want to make her a public example by bringing her before everyone and saying, "Look what she's done. She's evil. She's wicked. She's had an affair. She's had relationships out of wedlock." And the law said that she should have been stoned if she'd have done this. Thank God that he came to Joseph in a dream and told him chosen. This baby is from God. This is the Savior of the world. And therefore, Joseph took her as a wife. Now, this would have been tough for two teenagers. Hadn't been married. Here she is, ready to deliver. What kind of scorn and ridicule they must have went through. As we look upon people today that are young, not married, we see them having children, and most of the time we're shaking our head, you know, clicking the tongue, looking down upon them. And granted, it's wrong out of wedlock, but just imagine what they were going through as they had to do this. Now, verse 6 comes up and it says, "And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered." And as I mentioned at the very beginning, a lot of people, you know, think that she was ready to just pop right then. Now, she barely made it there. I've heard some people say she barely even made it there. And then they turned her away. She had to go have a baby right then. The Bible didn't say that. What does the Bible say? It says that the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. Granted, she was in the late stages of going to have a baby. She was great with child. I'll never say the other word that they use for having a baby. I was taught as a young man that that wasn't a good word to say, so I don't ever say it. Forgive me for that. But she is going to have a baby. She's great with child. And it didn't say that it happened upon the day that they got there. It didn't say that she was ready right then. It says the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. She brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now I want to look at this just quickly here where it says her firstborn son. Why did the Bible say her firstborn son? Do you know there's some people today that have the belief that Mary never engaged in any relationship with a man? That she remained a virgin her entire life. That's contrary to the teachings of the Bible. The Bible does not say that. This was her firstborn son. Later on, her and Joseph had other children. The Bible mentions Jesus' brothers and his sisters. Mary was not perfect. Everyone wants to think Mary was perfect. She was not perfect. The Bible clearly describes her as not being a perfect woman. So we're not going to raise her up and be above Jesus today. The evil innkeeper that a lot of folks like to talk about. Like I mentioned, one church that put on a pageant, all focused on the innkeeper's son who grew up to be Barabbas. The Bible never mentions an innkeeper. The word innkeeper is not in there. They didn't say they talked to anyone. They said they got there and there was no room for them in the inn. Have you ever been traveling, going somewhere, you're needing a hotel to stay in? I've been on business trips and not able to book a hotel, and I'm looking and there's signs everywhere, no vacancy, no vacancy. I imagine as Mary and Joseph went into Bethlehem, as everyone else was coming out to have to do this testing, this census, all the Roman soldiers and leaders that must have been there, they would have been occupying every inn that was even available. This was not a huge city. This wasn't like going to downtown New York or something where there's a place on every corner that you can stay. There was very limited places. But they get to the inn, there's no room there. It doesn't say an innkeeper came out and said, "Hey, you guys, no room. I see you're about to have a baby, but it doesn't matter to me because there's no room here." And a lot of people had that misconception that there was some angry innkeeper standing there turning away Jesus. Not so. The Bible doesn't say that. It says there was no room for them in the inn. Have you ever went somewhere you're going to go and the parking lot is completely full and you just look and you say, "Well, there's just no more room here." I never had to go into the store and say, "Is there any room in here?" No, I just looked at the parking lot and said, "There's no room." As they approached this inn, no doubt there was people with their camels, their donkeys, and whatever else was probably lined up as far as they could see, and they naturally assumed there's no room here. Maybe they did go in and talk to an innkeeper, but the Bible doesn't say that. What I wanted for us to do today is to make sure that we know what the Bible says, not what some book says, not what some movie says or some television show, but what the Bible says. We as Christians today need to be concerned about what the Bible says, because if we don't know what the Bible says, we can be misguided, we can be misleading, we can be taken down the wrong path by false teaching. We need to know what the Bible says. The Bible says there was no room for them in the inn. There was no wicked innkeeper mentioned. There was no room for Jesus then. Sadly, there's no room for Jesus now. As I was out this morning back here on the nature trail praying at the rock, I could hear all kinds of things going on in the neighborhood. I could hear cars buzzing up and down the road. I could hear somebody up here shooting guns. They have a firing range or something back there shooting guns. Heard people back in the subdivision back here making noises and things. And I was thinking, God, please let us be a shining light to this community that sadly doesn't feel the need or the urge to come into your house today to worship you. But they're doing all manners of things. And we as Christians today, if we're not careful, if we don't pay attention to our Bibles and read our Scripture and know what the Bible says, we could be led down the wrong roads. We could be just like these folks that don't know the need for a Savior and the need to be in His house. It says that they laid Him in a manger because there was no room for Him. I've also heard this manger described. We've got a replica of some kind of manger right here. Could look like that. May not. Don't know. The Bible doesn't say what the manger looked like. It didn't say where it was at. Didn't say that it was in a cave. I've heard people say that it was in a cave. Everybody knows it was in a cave. The Bible doesn't say it was in a cave. Heard people say that it was on the back side of the inn. The Bible doesn't say that. Heard people say that it was some barn, that Joseph went around looking everywhere for a place to have the baby, and he saw a barn, and he walked over to this barn, and they had the baby. The Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says they laid him in a manger because there was no room for him in the inn. Now, if we want to deduct from Scripture and think of it in our mind, we can naturally assume things. Like, they got there, everything was full, there was probably animals spread across everywhere. But we could probably imagine they probably had a place to keep animals and to feed them. He was laid in a manger. What's a manger? It's a feeding trough. It's a place where you feed animals. My dad used to raise pigs, and we had a feeding trough. I've mentioned this several times, usually when I'm preaching about the prodigal son. But we had a feeding trough for those pigs. It was about yay long. Well, it's about like the one we have in the manger. It's about yay long, about yay wide. Stood about this high off the ground. As we come and dump slop over into it, the pigs would eat. That was their manger. That's where they laid Jesus, in a feeding trough. Could have been in a cave. Could have been in some place. I doubt it was in a barn. Usually when the Bible mentions barns, it's talking about a granary or a threshing floor. The Bible mentions barns maybe four or five times. And each time it's referring to a threshing floor or a granary, a place where they keep food. They don't usually feed the animals in the same place they keep the food. So I doubt it was in a barn. Now, we think of barns because we got barns all around us in East Tennessee. The Bible doesn't say it was in a barn. It doesn't say it was in a cave. It says it was in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. I want us to be very careful this morning as we look at this story. It said they wrapped him in swaddling clothes. What swaddling clothes? Well, if you look back at the history of these people, and even today, in that same region of the country, they wrap their babies after they're delivered. They actually rub them with salt and vinegar, wrap strips of cloth around their limbs, around their bodies. They're almost like a mummy. They do this to protect their limbs and their organs and to make sure that they grow up straight. So Jesus, when he was born, he was wrapped with strips of cloth around his limbs, around his body, laid in that manger, keep him warm, keep him protected. I've also heard the same type of clothing is used for grave clothes. As Jesus came here to die for us, but he had to come as one of us in a lowly manger. Wrapped there in that flesh that he robed himself with, wrapped in swaddling clothes, death clothes. Verse 8 says, "And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid." We celebrate Christmas on December 25th. A lot of folks don't understand the reason behind that. A lot of people believe that's when Jesus was actually born. But if we read our scripture and we look at it, it said that the shepherds were abiding in the field. Shepherds normally don't abide in the field in the middle of the winter in December. It's very cold. Their feeding time, the pasture would would give growth and things during the season from spring on. Most likely this could have been in September when this happened. If you want to look at it that way, in September, if it had been in September, and you want to count back 9 months, possibly he was conceived by the Holy Spirit in December. We can look at it that way. The Bible does not say the date that Jesus was born. In fact, Christmas was actually created by the Roman Catholic Church. They came up with this holiday to replace the pagan holidays that people were having. They would celebrate and worship the return of the sun during the winter solstice. When the days began to get longer, it was around December 25th. And so they would have these great pagan holidays and feasts. They didn't call them holidays then. They didn't call them holidays until the Roman Catholics did. And by the way, the word holiday means holy day. A lot of us get upset, and I'm one of them, that when we see people advertise for Christmas, they say, "Happy holidays." I don't like that myself. But if they really knew the meaning of holiday, it's holy day. So we should say, "Thank you for recognizing this holy day." I was invited to an employee meal this last Friday at work. We were going to a restaurant. There was an email went out to about 15 of us, inviting us all there, describing it and everything. And they called, in the title of the email, it was Holiday Lunch. And even in the body of the message, "Come out to the holiday lunch. If you're interested in coming to the holiday lunch, we'll do this." And at first I got pretty angry. And I was like, I was going to fire back email, "I will not attend the holiday lunch. I'll come to a Christmas lunch, but no holiday lunch." And then I started thinking about that word holiday. I said, you know what? Holiday actually means holy day. I'm sure that these folks don't even understand that. So I kindly replied back to all the definition of holiday. And I had to spell it out in about 20 font. And it said, "Holiday, holy day, a day given to religious observance." And then I put on there, "Yes, I'll be there." I don't know why I didn't get any replies to that. Nobody ever replied to it. But anyway, we did have a holiday lunch, but I celebrated Christmas. So Christmas was created, and it's actually the name of Christmas means Christ Mass. It was a time that the Roman Catholics would have a special time together. Christmas it became, and it was a time when they would observe the Lord's Supper on December 25th. And it took place of this pagan holiday. We adopted this as evangelicals, as Baptists, we still follow the same thing. We celebrate Christmas as an observance of when our Lord was born. Probably wasn't the day. In fact, it most certainly probably was not the day. I notice that the Bible says that the angels came to the shepherds. Why didn't they go first to the king? There was a king on the throne. His name is Herod. Why didn't the angels go to King Herod and say, "Hey, king, there's been a baby born over here"? Why didn't they go to him first? Why didn't they go to the Why didn't they go to Caesar Augustus and say, "There's been a king born in Bethlehem. It's a great thing. The Savior of the world has been born"? Why wouldn't the angels have went to them first? It could have gotten broadcasted all over the world if you'd brought it to the people in charge. The Bible says that they went to the shepherds that were abiding in their fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Why would the angels go to the shepherds? Because the angel was coming to announce the birth of the great shepherd, the good shepherd, the Savior of the world. He went to the lowest of the low. He didn't go to the highest of the high. They went to the lowest of the low. Those that would know that there was this coming Savior, this Savior of the world, this child that was born in Bethlehem, was going to save the world. He went to those first. If you ever notice throughout your Bible, that it works that way. It's usually the ones that we feel are insignificant. Those that are really not important. Shepherds. Nobody had anything to do with shepherds. Shepherds sat out there in the field. Shepherds stunk. Shepherds didn't go around anybody. They sat around all the time with all these animals. They were low. They wouldn't even allow them into certain places because of their stench. But the angels went to the shepherds because Jesus is the great shepherd. Angel said to them, "Fear not." Why did he have to say this? Why did the angel have to tell the shepherds not to fear? Aren't angels little lovely white creatures that flit around and sing and go on? Aren't these little cherubs sitting here on these posts? Isn't that angels? Aren't they little beautiful creatures? Why would they be scared of those? You've got the wrong conception of an angel. Every time the Bible talks about angels coming on the scene, men are feared. Men are falling on their faces in fear. Angels came to those men that were guarding the tomb of Jesus. And as they come over that tomb and they met to these men, they were afraid. They fell down on the ground as dead. This angel come and wrestled Jacob. That all night wrestling match. Angels were fearful people, not people. They're created by God. They're sons of God, the Bible says. In fact, the Bible never mentions an angel being a woman. Touched by an Angel was a great television show. And Roma Downey no doubt made a great angel. The angel never mentions a lady angel. The Bible never mentions it. It's always referring to the males, sons of God. Created beings made by God. Not little tiny flitting things that go around singing merrily. They do announce the coming of the Savior. And no doubt they do sing. Probably not our little lovely little hymns that we like as much. The shepherds were the first to know. They fell down. They were sore afraid, the Bible said. But the angel told them not to be afraid because they come bringing tidings, good tidings of great joy. I shall be to all people. The angel goes on to say, "For is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." So the angels came immediately on the day that Jesus was born and told the shepherds of his birth. Didn't wait any, went straight to them and told them. And it's going to come back to us in just a minute while I mention that. Suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest on earth. Peace, goodwill toward men." We get a lot of our Christmas hymns from things from the Bible, and then they get embellished by men of certain things. And we love to hear them. I love to sing them myself. "Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright." It mentions little baby Jesus laying there. Never made a sound, never cried. The Bible never mentions that Jesus made a sound. It never mentions that he didn't cry. Although we have a misconception from him that he never made a sound, never cried. He may not have. May have been the perfect baby. May not have had colic like all of our kids had. I guess Mary didn't ever have to put him on top of the dryer or the washing machine to calm him down. But the Bible never says that Jesus didn't cry. Most babies cry when they came out. Let's see what the Bible says. Verse 15 says, "And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, 'Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known unto us.'" Well, the angels were not hanging around. It says that they went to heaven. They left the shepherds and went to heaven. Perhaps there were other angels there. The Bible doesn't say. The Bible doesn't say that there was angels above the manger and they were singing Silent Night. It doesn't say that. Perhaps there were. But the angels went to heaven, it said. And then the shepherds said one to another, "Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass." These are shepherds. Do you realize they become the first missionaries? When they were touched by the things of Jesus, when they understood the truth that the angels told them about Jesus, the first thing they wanted to do was go and see. When Jesus gets a hold of you, when Jesus gets into your heart, you want to go and you want to see. You want to be with him. You want to hear about him. You want to tell about him. And we see that that's exactly what the shepherds did. The angels didn't tell them, go around telling everybody. But the Bible says that they went and told this abroad. Everybody heard about it. They said one to another, "Let us now go even into Bethlehem and see this thing." So the first visitors the Bible talks about that saw Jesus besides Mary and Joseph and the angels were shepherds. Did you see three kings mentioned? Did you see three wise men mentioned? No, but the book of Matthew says that there was wise men that came from the east to see Jesus. However, they didn't say that he came to see them on the day he was born. In fact, it was probably 2 years later that these wise men came, these magi from the east, that saw Jesus. Actually, they didn't even come to the manger. They came to a house, the Bible says. They came to a house. Jesus had already been moved from the manger. And it says that they came to see the child. He was no longer a baby in a manger when the wise men came. The Bible never mentions three wise men. Gasp, Brother Byron, what are you saying? The Bible says that they brought him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So naturally, we deduct there must have been three guys there with a gift each. There was three guys. Somebody made up a hymn said three kings. These were not kings, these were magi. These were astrologers, people that looked at the stars, and they saw the star over Bethlehem, and then traveled for long distance to go see where this baby was, this child at that time. So, sorry, there's no three kings mentioned. There might have been two wise men. Maybe they had one of them had two gifts, one had one. Maybe one guy carried all three gifts. Maybe there were 15 wise men. The Bible doesn't say. But the Bible says that they brought three gifts, and they were wise men. That's over in the book of Matthew. We didn't read that. You can read that in your own time. It says in verse 16, and they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. As I mentioned, these shepherds now become the first missionaries as they go and tell the tale of Jesus. My friend, when you experience Jesus, you want to tell people. You want people to know that what's in your heart, and you'd like to see it in their heart. And they made known abroad, just like Paul did on these all these lessons for 20 weeks. We've been teaching about Paul on Wednesday nights. Paul is one of the greatest missionaries that ever lived. My friend, these shepherds became the first missionaries because they told abroad about Jesus. Verse 18 says, and all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as was told to them. This word ponder means that she weighed out what she had heard and what she had saw. She weighed them out in her mind and heart and thought on them. And thought about it in her heart and her mind. As I mentioned this morning in devotion, we need to be the same way. As we read through Scripture, we need to ponder upon it. We need to meditate upon it and ask the Lord what is in the Scripture. That's why this morning I'm trying to drive home the fact that we need to understand what the Bible says. What does the Bible say concerning this child? We read it right here, plain black and white in our Bibles. What the Bible says. So as we go through this Christmas season, this Holy Day season, through this time that we worship Christ in our families, in our homes, in our church, let's remember the real Christmas story. What really happened? What the Bible really said? Did you miss it in this 20 verses? Did you miss what the Bible said about this Christmas story? What's it about? It's about the Savior. It's about one that came to save His people. The one that came to forgive men of all their sins. This child is God. God in the flesh. God robed Himself in the flesh and came down here to live amongst us. The filth that we are. He came in a filthy manger. I've never seen a clean manger. I've never seen a place where they'd be animals clean. The Savior of the world that could have been born in a king's palace, that could have had everything, came and was born in a nasty, low manger to be with nasty, lowly people like me and like you. Why did He do this? The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Everlasting. Whosoever. It didn't say kings in palaces. It didn't say emperors upon the throne. It said whosoever. He loved us. That's why He came. Why He came to that nasty, lowly manger to be with us sinners. So that He could lead us to the knowledge of Christ. We can spend eternity in heaven with God the Father. As we close this message, I'd like to ask Charlotte to come up and play. I want to ask you something this morning. Do you spend your Christmases concerned about what you're going to buy people? Is somebody going to like what you got? no doubt to do, we do. You go buy gifts for people and you think, well, I hope they like this, I hope they like it. Think they'll take it back, you think it'll fit. You think I can get in the mall? So I went down the road the other day, people were in the middle of the road in the red lights trying to get in the mall. There wasn't enough room for everybody. We're so concerned about getting in there, getting that present, getting somebody a gift. Have you received the real gift? Have you received the real gift that God sent on that day? It's Mary and the Virgin, bearing that Son, Jesus, the Savior of the world, who came here to save us from our sins. Because without a Savior, we're doomed. Without a Savior, we have no hope. Without a Savior, we will die, and we will go to hell, and we will burn forever in a devil's lake of fire. But because of that Savior that was sent to us on that Christmas, we have a way to heaven. We have a way to be with the Father. We can know what Christmas is really about. It's about Jesus Christ and His love for us. Let's stand this morning. Person in the sound of my voice understands and realizes the importance of Christmas. Lord, it's not about the gifts. It's not about the hymns. It's not about the cookies and the candy and the toys. And God, it's about you. It's about you robing yourself with flesh and coming down to save people from their sins. Lord, we never sought after you. You sought us. You came to seek and save us. God, I pray that each person has that gift, Lord, that you so freely gave. Lord, if there's one in this building today that needs something from you, Lord, whether it's the gift of salvation, Lord, whether they need to come forward because they're in a backslidden condition, Lord, if they say it's going on in their life, they need prayer. Lord, I pray that today they'll make their way down to this altar so we can pray with them. God, work in the minds and hearts of each person in this building. Help us, Lord. Lord, those that may hear this message outside of this church, God, if there's one that needs a Savior, God, may you convict their heart, Lord, through the Holy Spirit, show them their need. Lord, help us hear them. For it's these things we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. If there's one in this house this morning that needs prayer, I want to urge you to come down this morning and pray. Pray with me. Salvation, backslidden.